Let me get up the rundown.
Yeah, this is going to be our Christmas episode.
Merry Christmas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Joy
to the world.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way.
Did you hear that?
Why don't you just say it? The worst toy maker in the world. A cotton-headed ninny muggins.
Welcome to Irritable Dad Syndrome. Batteries are not included. Give it up for your hosts, Mike and Darren.
Hey, I'm Darren.
I'm Mike.
Welcome to Irritable Dad Syndrome. This is episode 121.
11 times 11.
Yes. You said you were going to do that. We haven't done the math in forever.
This is the end. This is the last live recording of season 3.
Well, of 2022.
Which is season, we do seasons by years.
That's right.
So
yes.
Season, this is the season finale, as it were.
Yes. So you people, part one. You people, y'all, are in for a treat because Mike and I are going to record 3 episodes tonight, in
good
theory.
God.
We'll see. Tonight on the show, I'm going to talk about, you know, we call ourselves Irritable Dad Syndrome, and rarely do we get into why we're so irritable, and I'll tell you exactly why I'm irritable, and it's because of school projects that I'm tired of having to do.
Yeah, and I want to talk a little bit about the new Indianapolis Jones. <It's, So.
laughs> We named the dog Indiana.
That's right. Yeah.
And another thing that got me all irritable is my son parked his car in a horrible spot. And I had to drive, turn the car around,
living room.
Go back down to new. I had to turn the car around and go back to where we were, and I had to get his car out of a parking lot, and it was fun.
Welcome to the show.
Welcome to Irritable Dad Syndrome.
That's right.
Before we start, I wanted to throw a shout out to Michael Flannery, friend of the show, friend of mine, friend of yours. Mm-hmm. He has a game show on Facebook every day, weekdays at 5 o'clock. So if you go on Facebook, I know a lot of people do not live in the greater Cincinnati area where Michael is from. But if you go on Facebook, you can follow Michael Flannery. And at 5 o'clock, you can play Know-It-Alls. It's a trivia game show. And what he's been doing, he's been giving away scratchers, okay, lottery tickets. So for a chance at winning $5,000 on a scratcher, you don't even have to buy the lottery ticket. He buys them. So, and it's fun. He is a funny guy, and it's a great show. So check it out, Know-It-Alls. He's been plugging us like crazy. So, Michael, we thank you for that, and we want you to do that. Mike?
You know, we talked briefly before we went live about the need for employees.
That's right. Are we hiring?
Yeah, I would like to hire
an engineer.
An Irritable Dad Syndrome lackey. Mm-hmm. An intern.
A flunky.
A flunky. someone to make me coffee. Someone to make sure the levels are right, make sure the internet's on.
Yeah, make sure we're recording.
Make sure we're recording.
Yeah.
Edit. I would like to get someone to edit. I would like to transpose.
Now, you see, I don't think I could ever let somebody edit the show, the audio version of the show.
Well, here's,
that's my baby.
Here's where I am.
You're the only person who I trust to edit my baby.
We are in the age, this is 2022, Darren.
Yes.
We're supposed to be talking to aliens by now.
Right.
There are AI things that you can get involved in that will write copy for you. If you want to write a funny story,
right,
you can just feed in a couple of words to a program
and
it'll write a post for you. We are in the end times. And I'm thinking that we could work with an artificial intelligence company and develop something that could edit for us that has our own sensibilities, that would know when to quack, that would know when to go out on the internet and find a fart sound effect and put it in.
Right.
It would know exactly how much of the song of the artist you just saw in concert to put in the thing before it becomes a problem for the thing.
Turns me on, evil, evil, turns me on.
I'm thinking this is going to take years to train something to do that.
I mean, we put a man on the moon.
Yes, we did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even though it's a big flat circle in the sky.
It is. Well, there's two moons. There's the white moon, and then there's the black moon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. This is new to me.
Yeah. Well, we've talked about this several times on the podcast.
And many things on the podcast are new to me.
I wish you would stop denying its factness.
You know the
factability.
You know the movie Memento?
Yeah, I love
that
movie.
I'm in a weird, funky state right now where my memory only lasts about 20 to 30 seconds. gosh, I'm concerned because you pointed out some things in the rundown that are mine.
Yeah.
I don't remember these things. I don't know what the hell this is.
I just, you know, I follow you and I follow your wife on Facebook or the Facebook.
Uh-huh.
And she mentions things. I'm like, oh, I'm sure Mike's going to want to talk about that. So I put it on the rundown. Yeah. And then you're like, I don't know.
Well, let me give you an example of where my brain is today.
Sure.
So in the holiday season, people, we always watch the Rocky and Creed series.
Right.
From Rocky 1 through.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I said a couple of years ago on the show, I was shocked that Charlie was actually into Rocky 1. If you go back and watch Rocky 1, I mean, the fight is about 15 minutes at the end.
Mm-hmm.
All the rest of it is him like punching dead cows, yelling at Polly, trying to talk to a parakeet in the in the shop, and being basically a tough dude for the mob, like a guy.
He breaks fingers.
Breaks fingers. He's people like, oh, you're going to pay me the thing.
Yeah.
He's that guy.
Yeah,
that's Rocky.
That was my favorite line.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You pay me the thing.
You got to pay me the thing. And he named the turtles Cuff and Link.
And we were watching it, and he was in the pet store. Hey, yo, Adrian, I got to, you know, let's put a hat on the bird here and give it a seed, and it'll tweet. And I look over, and Charlie is enraptured with this movie. I'm like, buddy, do you want to?
That's the best Sylvester Stallone I've ever heard. From you.
Yeah. I said, buddy, do you want to watch something else? He's like, no, this is amazing. Yeah. This is great. This is wonderful.
Yeah.
And we watched the entire thing. We get to Creed. It was exciting. It's beautiful. All that stuff. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's where I'm at. So I'm telling my friends about this. I have other friends.
Okay.
And I'm telling how the family comes together with Rocky. It starts with me and Charlie.
Yeah.
And then Andrew, I said, will pass through and consistently ask, is he fighting the Russian yet?
Right.
Rocky IV.
Yes.
I think we all know the musical.
I will break you.
Yeah. And then I told my friends.
There's no easy way out.
Yeah. So then I'm a Rocky fan. I told my friends, so Andrew usually gets involved in Rocky III.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't fight the Russian in Rocky
III. No, that's Clever Lang.
It's one tech. If I read the previous text that I wrote myself or took 2 seconds to access the memory banks that hold the entire Rocky timeline and lore, I would know that's a stupid text to send. I sent that text today.
Okay.
I'm an idiot.
You sent the text that Andrew likes Rocky 3 when you meant to say Andrew likes Rocky 4.
Yeah.
How dare you?
And I ate McDonald's right before this show.
Okay.
Which makes the entirety of me feel oily on the inside.
I still like McDonald's. I can't help it.
It's not that I don't... You know... when we were watching,
for listeners, we're going to get to something in a minute. I promise. Go ahead.
You know
Mike.
When you watch Dahmer?
Yeah. Speaking of McDonald's,
and he's frying up a dude's liver or something.
Yes.
And you're thinking, you gotta be dead inside to do that, to eat that, and he's eating it. And the first time he does, he looks a little bit like he regrets it.
Right. And he's like, that's pretty good.
That's how I am every time I eat McDonald's. I feel like that. Well, I feel like I need to go to the police and offer a confession.
What do you get at McDonald's?
The 2 cheeseburger meal, number 7, large with a Diet Coke.
Okay.
Large because I like the fries. Large fries.
I like the fries too.
I think they're too much for a human adult male. But I get them because I want a plethora of leftover fries.
Okay.
Ain't nothing worse than still wanting a fry. And the only thing left in there is that little tortilla chip fry that's, you know.
I tell you what I really like is the double cheeseburger. And here's why.
I can't.
Because they rarely ever, but you'll get 2 cheeseburgers. But you can't eat a double cheeseburger. What the hell?
I can't take that burger to,
it's the burger to meat ratio, the bun to
I'm also a hypocrite.
Okay.
Hey, what happened?
No, because rarely do people order the double cheeseburger.
Yeah.
So they always make that fresh. Okay.
Fresh.
No mustard,
onion.
And I can almost eat it in one bite.
Fresh has no place in McDonald's. Fresh means it came out of the freezer.
Well,
sooner.
It's fresher than the other things.
All right.
So,
welcome to the show.
Welcome to Irritable Dad Syndrome.
This portion of our show is brought to you by the Butter Cutter. Hi, I'm Dave Lay, and I love to cook, and I love to host dinner parties. Well, if you ask me, the most important part of dinner is the butter. A nice pat of real butter placed directly on a freshly baked dinner roll turns a regular meal into an enjoyable eating experience. You might not know this, but I have OCD, and nothing grinds my gears more than when one pat of butter is larger than the other. And that's where the Butter Cutter comes in. With this revolutionary product, you can cut a stick of butter into 16 even pieces. And just like that, everybody's happy. So make your next dinner party a success with the Butter Cutter. Available wherever fine kitchen products are sold. Now back to the show.
I've got a question.
Yeah.
And I wanted to know, and this is going to involve some cussing. I want to know when Daryl Hall became such an asshole.
Well, you got to tell me about this because I don't know. Which one's Daryl Hall? Is he the...
He's the tall blonde one. Of Daryl Hall. He's half
Crockett.
Of Daryl Hall and John Oates.
Okay, all right.
Yes, he is Crockett of Crockett and Tubbs.
Yes, okay.
Yes. I saw an interview that he did with Bill Maher. And one, he's wearing this, like a Panama Jack hat, like he's at the beach.
He looks like a guy that would wear a Panama Jack hat.
And I have never seen him like this. A few years ago, he was on Howard Stern. And Howard Stern kept poking and poking and poking him, talking about how, and you hate John Oates. No, man, John Oates and I were buddies, we're pals, and he wrote this song, and he wrote this song, and he wrote this song. And we've been together all these years, and we're like a family and whatever. Something has changed.
Okay.
And you and I joke about how we need, you know, couple counseling.
Yeah.
Daryl Hall and John Oates, I don't know that they're ever going to be in the same room again. I'm concerned.
Well, did this happen after John Oates toured with Sasquatch?
I don't know.
Did Sasquatch come in between them?
Probably. Mm. Yeah, I don't know when this interview happened because there wasn't a date on it that I could see. But Bill Maher said, so, you know, you and John Oates are partners. He's like, he's not my partner. He is not my partner. We are not partners. Yeah. He goes, but you're, you know, you're musical partners. Oh, yeah, we're musical partners. Sure.
How was he saying?
But
they were
not
dating?
Partners.
Okay.
So they're not business partners, but they're musical partners.
Yeah.
Or whatever. And he just gets irate.
Well,
and he won't stop.
I've noticed that recently people will refer to their significant other as their partner.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to start doing that.
Yeah, like, you're my partner.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're my podcast partner.
But I would love to, like, go somewhere with Bess and say, this is my partner, Bess.
I think that would work.
Just the nature of this relationship, you know?
Yeah, we are partners. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But he, in this interview, Bill Maher asked about one song. He goes, I can't remember the song because I can't remember anything. But he's like, oh, yeah, that was all me. That song is all me. All me. Me. Me, 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 me. It's all me.
You know.
And then he asked him about something else. Yeah, that was me. John wasn't even on that. John didn't do anything for that. It's all me. Me, me, me.
Yeah, I saw an unfortunate interview with Ed Roland of Collective Soul.
Collective Soul.
He was being interviewed by the rock guy. The rock. He's got like a...
Dwayne The Rock Johnson?
No. He's got a YouTube channel, Doctor of Rock or Philosopher of Rock.
Oh, yes. The guy with the Frank Sinatra hat.
Yeah.
And I like his interviews, but they don't need to go 45 minutes.
Yeah, so he was interviewing him.
He can trim it down a bit.
And I forget the name of the guitarist that left Collective Soul. I can't
They've
remember.
Had three or four. Yeah,
This is like the original. I think it was like one of the original guys. And he asked him a question about it, and about a song. And Ed Roland was like, whoa, 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 whoa. He had nothing to do with that song. That was mine.
Right.
And I mean, the tone of the interview was like jokey and everything, uh-huh. and it got really serious to the point where Frank Sinatra hat guy said, and he said, just, I want to make sure that's clear when we go through this. That was my song. He didn't talk. He didn't write a word.
Right.
He didn't write a note. Mm. He didn't write any lyrics to that song.
Yeah.
No sound that came from that song. No guitar, no bass, no drums, no vocals, no maracas. Nothing.
No harmonica
came from him.
Yeah,
and I want to make that exceptionally clear. Like I said, okay. Well,
wow.
Let's. You got any pets? You know.
It was weird. Inception. Did you like that?
Because I don't see him as being that. I've always seen. They've always seemed like nice.
Yeah. You know? Well, that was the thing with Daryl Hall. Every time I've seen him, and granted, I haven't seen a lot of him.
I always get him mixed up with Huey Lewis.
Okay, that makes
like,
no
like
sense at all.
They're the same guy to me.
Now, granted, they sang together on We Are the World. Maybe that's where it was.
Mm.
But I don't know. I've always seen Daryl Hall, and I always thought that Daryl Hall was somewhat of a cool individual.
Yeah.
But, man, it got uncomfortable just watching this interview with him. So, Daryl, if you and John are going through some things, Mike and I want to have you on the show, and we can bring John on, too. And Megan Mitchell will come. She'll be a mediator and sit in the middle, and we can work this out.
Indiana Jones.
Oh, the new trailer for Indiana Jones?
Yeah.
It looks awesome.
Yeah, I don't know, man.
You don't know that... I think
I'm having trouble with it.
I don't like the title of the movie.
Yeah, the
Dial of Destiny.
Okay.
It's a stupid title.
I think it would be funny if they solve the problem at the end of the movie and it says drink more Ovaltine when he uses the dial. I'm not that excited.
Drink more Ovaltine.
Yeah. I'm not that excited. Like, I was excited for Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. I didn't think it was as bad as... I think people poo-pooed that way too much.
Libby and I were laughing our ass off at Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. When they're on the Jeep and they're going up the road...
It was a video game.
And he jumps off and he's swinging through the trees being chased by the monkeys.
Yeah.
And the whole time the Jeep keeps driving and driving and driving, goes up north, hangs a right, goes east a little bit, and then turns and goes south.
Yeah.
About a half a mile, and then he jumps out of the woods, back into the Jeep.
Yeah,
bull.
Yeah.
I know that's like Darren. It's a movie, and like there's not going to be the thousand snakes and all the rats, and when he ran from the ball, and all the stuff is there's fake, okay.
Yeah,
but then there's like, okay, this is stupid.
Well, fake. I saw two things that I saw a lot of internet hate for it. One was, it's aliens. Why all the other ones were grounded in reality, and this is aliens. Like all the other ones were grounded in reality. They were grounded. So when was the moment when the Nazis opened a box in the desert and their faces melted off?
Or
where is that story where the guy reached in and pulled a beating heart out and showed it to another guy and dropped him into a volcano? Or
totally possible.
Or the thing where somebody got shot and they poured out of a cup onto it and he's okay again and riding a horse with Gimli just 5 minutes later? All those were perfectly acceptable, but an alien?
But in Latin, what Jehovah starts with an I. Yeah.
That one, and then the refrigerator with the nuclear bomb. I thought that was fun.
Yeah.
Indiana Jones is fun.
It is fun.
It's supposed to be fun. I mean, everybody thought that the ball rolling through the temple in Raiders of the Lost Ark was amazing. It is amazing.
It is amazing.
But think about it.
Right.
It's a ball rolling on a thing.
That would hurt.
Yeah.
That would crush you.
So they put all these traps, this tribe or whatever, put all these traps throughout there.
Mm-hmm.
All the arrows and the pits and all this
you
stuff.
Step on the thing.
And the head engineer of this tribe said, somebody might make it through all these things, but I'm going to put a big ball up here.
Right.
And it's going to come down this track that no one's seen the entire time Indy's going through these things.
That is right.
All of a sudden, this windy passage that he went through becomes a straight shot with a ball track going down it. And all he has to do is run out, and then I don't know where the ball went. It would have been more. I think they should go back and George Lucas.
Did it bust through the wall?
It went out, I think, or maybe it stopped.
It's probably still going.
I think, George Lucas went back and changed all the Star Wars.
Uh-huh.
I think they should make a new cut of Raiders of the Lost Ark when he's running from the
soccer ball.
Yeah. When he's running from the tribe and they're throwing the you just see the ball off in the distance rolling off.
It's just still going.
Yeah.
No, if it hit like a bunch of. Those idols, those big like Easter Island things, and they fell over like bowling pins.
Yeah,
that'd be cool.
It just makes me. I guess it just makes me sad a little bit because he looks really old in it.
Well, he is really
old. He is really old, but it makes me sad because Indy is like the smart ass. I mean, he's for you millennials and other weirdos out there.
Yeah,
he's basically our Chris Pratt. I think Chris Pratt is the new. That guy in movies.
There was rumor going around that Chris Pratt was going to be the new Indiana Jones when they reboot it.
But here's the deal.
And they asked Harrison Ford, who do you think should be the new Indiana Jones? And he says, I'll tell you, nobody.
Yeah.
When I die, he dies. Yeah. And he points.
Yeah.
He dies.
But I say that. And I also say that there's no way in hell Chris Pratt would ever be as cool as Harrison Ford as Indiana Jones. It's just who he is. That's him. I think that's just him.
Yeah.
Anyway, I saw the trailer and then I was looking at there's some bloopers from Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Yeah.
And they're interesting because it's not like normal bloopers like you see with Will Ferrell or whatever, where they're just having fun with it.
Right.
It's bloopers and the guy's like, oh, this is my big shot at movie. Like he's more serious than normal. So you like they walk the thing and everybody else is laughing. He comes up, was I not supposed to walk in the thing? And you hear Steven Spielberg back there yelling something. He goes, I'm sorry, the vine came down and hit me in the face. I didn't. It's like, chill out, dude.
Yeah,
chill.
Stump Woodley makes a good point that Indiana Jones became dumb when Sean Connery played his father. Sean Connery was 10 years older than him.
Yeah.
Okay, in theory, but he's an actor. Marlon Brando was only a few years older than Al Pacino when he made The Godfather. So that kind of puts that to rest.
Well, I think
but I loved The Last Crusade.
Last Crusade was right there. It was great. I think Raiders of the Lost Ark is the perfect Indiana Jones movie. Mm-hmm. Last Crusade. If we got into a fight, if you said, I'm going to debate you and I'm mm-hmm. going to fight you on which one's better, I'd be like, I could totally, Last Crusade, yeah, it's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not going to fight. I have nothing bad to say about it.
Well, if Kingdom of the Crystal Skull hadn't have been such bullshit, they wouldn't have made this fifth one. Okay.
You think that's what it is?
Oh, it's absolutely what it is.
Yeah.
They just had such a bad taste in their mouth.
Yeah.
And George Lucas isn't involved in this one.
Oh, he's not.
No. Steven Spielberg and Harrison Ford. But George Lucas doesn't have anything to do with it. He may have a producer credit or something.
Do you think they were like drinking some whiskey over at Spielberg's house?
Maybe we ought to tell George to go put some tauntauns in something else.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're going to de-prequelize this.
We're going to de-prequelize.
Make a good movie.
Yeah. So I hope it's good.
I do too.
Because I grew up with Harrison Ford. When I was a kid, I wanted to be Han Solo. And then I got to a certain age where I realized that that's impossible. Okay. Because spaceships are fake.
Yeah.
Wookiees are fake. And the laser guns that they used were fake.
Yeah.
So then I'm like, well, I can totally be Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
That's real. Yeah. Yeah. I idolized him. When I was a kid, we had all these woods behind our house. And I was like all the time. You ever climb trees when you were a kid?
Yeah.
I was climbing trees and jumping creeks and rocks and just, mm-hmm. God, I played Indiana Jones more times than I can even possibly fathom.
We made ninja stars out of the tops of mason jar lids and threw them at each other.
Yeah,
we were idiots.
You threw them at each other.
Yeah.
So not only would you risk being cut, but then you're going to get had to have your tetanus shot.
Yeah, we were stupid.
So, but it also has the chick from Fleabag. Did you ever watch Fleabag?
No.
The actress who is in Fleabag, which was on.
That's not what's her face, Karen Allen.
No. No,
who is, okay. That's what I thought. I was watching it on like a phone.
There's some young thing in her. I think she's in her 30s in this movie, okay. And she was in Fleabag, and it's a funny show.
Is she his nurse in the movie?
It's time to take your pills, Mr. Indiana.
Nothing but love for Indiana Jones, but
we've got clean pajamas.
Every time it showed him like running or shooting or doing a thing or punching, I'm like, I don't know, man.
Yeah,
I don't know.
He punches and he's like, his arthritis is acting up.
Yeah, it's like if you watched
Indiana Jones looks for his keys.
Yeah, for a long time, if you watch Clint Eastwood movies, like the first, you know, like in The Few Dollars More and all that stuff, when it showed him punching, it was like a full shot of him punching a guy. And then the older he got, you would see him like make the fist and retch back. And then you'd see from behind, clearly a 20-year-old with like a wig going, you know, it's like that over the top, like 1950s movie punch. Like I'm putting my whole back into
it. Well, that reminds me because I work for Antenna TV now. Uh-huh. And I was going through a bunch of episodes trying to find clips from Family Ties.
Okay.
And there's the episode where Tom Hanks is on there. And Tom Hanks is the alcoholic uncle. Okay. And he and Alex get into a bit of a thing. And Alex is trying to get him to put down the phone or something. And Hanks whips around and takes a swing and misses Alex by like a country mile.
Oh, yeah.
And you hear you hear the punch before you see the punch.
Yeah.
And you didn't see the punch. And I was watching it thinking, you know, if I was Gary David Goldberg, I would have done that again.
Maybe not go with the first take on
that.
We're
going to do that again.
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody, great. Steven, Elise, perfect. Mallory, great. Yeah. We're going to do that again.
Yeah. Could you at least be in the same room when you punch?
Exactly.
This portion of our show is brought to you by the Buick Skylark and your local Buick dealer. Since 1953, Skylark has been on the job with style and grace. Right, Peppy?
That's right, Dave. We sure do like our Skylark.
That's right, Peppy. Yes, we do. And now Skylark for 74 has the new 350 engine. It's more powerful than before and pollutes less and gets an amazing 12 miles to the gallon. Skylark for 74. Style and grace for any budget. Now back to the show.
I mentioned at the beginning of the show that I'm tired of school projects. Yeah. It was like a month or two ago I was bitching about a Rube Goldberg project,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they did it to us again. My son Cameron comes home and he has to make a mousetrap car. Okay.
I don't know what a mousetrap car is.
Okay. So you take three rulers.
Yeah.
And then you drill some holes in the front and the back. And then you put a...
Of the rulers?
Of the rulers.
Okay.
And you put a wooden rod through them.
Yeah.
And then with old... They recommend old DVDs. I have these old CDs that I used to burn. So I have four blank CDs that I make. They're for the tires. They're the tires.
Yeah.
Then with hot glue or super glue, you take a mouse trap and you glue it to the back.
Sounds like a very uncomfortable car to ride.
Well, no, you can't ride it. My fat ass would break it like that. And I can't snap my fingers now because of my thumb.
So does the mouse trap power it? Is that what it...
Yes.
Okay.
So you put another wooden rod on the metal contraption that kills the mouse.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You pull it back.
Uh-huh.
And you tie a string to the end of the wooden rod that's attached to the mouse trap.
Okay.
You with the dental floss, you wind it up, and then the string pulls the wooden rod at the back, which moves the tires, and it's supposed to go a couple of meters.
Okay.
Okay. Cameron has no idea what he's doing. I mean, he's 14. Why would he? And I don't have a drill set. So we went to my neighbor Chris's house, Chris Michael, thank you.
Yeah.
And he drilled the holes for us into the rulers. But we had to go to the Walmart. We had to buy rulers. We had to buy the rods, the wooden rods.
Yeah.
We had to buy a mousetrap. No, they provided the mousetrap.
Oh.
We had to buy super glue and some hot glue. And we had dental floss. And then what else did we have to buy? So we had to buy all the pieces to it.
Yeah.
And then we're trying to assemble this.
Did you have to put like rubber on the tire so that they would actually get grip? Or it seems like it would go...
That's a very good question, Mike.
Yeah.
What you do is you take...
I am an engineer.
You take a balloon and you cut a strip off the balloon and then wrap that around the DVD.
Okay.
And then it essentially gets grip, right?
Okay.
So we're building this mousetrap car.
Okay.
Okay. And we've got the rulers cut. Mm-hmm. We've got everything in place. We got the mousetrap glued on. We're putting the tires on it. And when we put the tires on, there's no separation from the tire to the side of the car.
Oh.
And I was saying, well, that's going to cause friction. It's going to rub against the side.
Yeah.
And so I said, Cameron, ask your teacher what he recommends we should do with this. And he says, put some cardboard in between.
Okay.
And I'm thinking, well, cardboard's going to cause friction too. And then a brilliant idea of mine.
Okay.
Little carpet felt pads that you put at the bottom of your chair so that it doesn't scratch your furniture.
Yeah.
We drilled some holes in those, put them on, and that actually helped align the tires.
Okay.
And we put them on and everything. We got the car built.
Uh-huh.
We wound it up. We set it on the ground. Goes nowhere.
Hey, what happened?
Won't move 1/9 of an inch. It will not go. So we're all just the four of us are thinking, damn it. So we tried it again, nothing. Tried it again, nothing. Tried it again, nothing. And then the teacher, Cameron brought it to school.
Uh-huh.
And his teacher says, well, I think the felt pads that your dad put on there is causing friction. So it's my fault.
Okay.
And I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
So he brings it home. So I've got to pull the tires apart, which is fun because everything's super glued together. Got to pull the wheels off, do the whole thing. And essentially, we took some straws that were bigger than the rods and cut them on the side to give it some distance from the car.
Okay.
But anyway, we finally got the thing going. Libby and I got an 8+ on it. But there's the thing. I work for a living.
Yeah.
I went to school.
Uh-huh.
Okay?
Yeah.
I've done all my projects.
Yeah.
Okay? I graduated high school and college.
Yeah.
And I'm tired of school projects.
Yeah. You're never done.
I'm tired of them.
You're going to have grandkids. You're going to have to do projects for them.
No.
So
that's the boys are going to be doing that.
So Stump is asking, at what temperature will the car melt? And I do have an answer.
Well, it's a wooden mousetrap, so.
Well, the CDs will melt at 74.38 degrees Celsius.
Oh, okay.
So.
Oh, and that is what in Fahrenheit?
More.
And then what is that in, what's the third, what's that in Kelvin? In
Kelvin, right? There's Rankine.
Is there another temperature?
Yeah. It's basically the
Did you
Fahrenheit
hear
version of Kelvin.
Stop, back that up. Is there another temperature?
Yeah.
Did you hear how excited I was that there's a fourth temperature?
Yeah.
Rankine? That's fake.
It's not.
Star Trek.
It's Kelvin Fahrenheit scale.
Uh-huh.
I think. Wait. I don't know. I learned about it, what is this? 20 years ago?
Because I thought there were three.
No. Celsius, Fahrenheit, Kelvin, and Rankine.
Who uses Celsius? The commies?
Yeah, yeah. Everybody but the United States.
Okay.
And Britain.
Because it's part of the metric system?
No. Celsius is the metric system.
Okay.
And Kelvin is based on the metric system.
Okay,
Kelvin is based on Celsius.
Okay, so what I want to know is zero. What temperature did they use in the Bible? Because that's the only one I'm using. All them other sons of bitches, they can use their devil temperatures. Yeah. I'm using the one that was in the Bible.
Thou shalt not.
Use Kelvin.
Use Kelvin.
But yeah, I'm done. Okay, because the last Rube Goldberg thing about broke us. Okay, these projects are tearing our family apart.
I want to talk about Kelvin some more.
Okay.
So,
I've hit a nerve.
My favorite thing about Kelvin, this is something that I love about science and engineering.
Okay, Mike, what do you love about Kelvin?
About how impersonally useless the idea of Kelvin is. So Kelvin is there so that you can quantify what absolute zero is, the point at which there is absolutely zero heat. And the only way you get there is if everything stops moving. Not just like you're like caught. Like somebody caught you getting the last you're getting the last ice cream sandwich out and they catch you. Not that. I'm talking like all processes stop, all atoms cease to move, all electrons quit going around. Like everything is just like you can never see it. You can never observe it. It's simply there to make the equations work. And I get it. I mean, if somebody right now is furiously typing on their little thing that they're listening to this on. You don't know the first thing. I do. And I get what you're saying. I get it.
Oh, this is where people are going to get pissed. And like, hell no.
After 120 episodes.
Don't you dare diss Kelvin, you son of a bitch.
I'm dissing Kelvin.
Yeah.
No, I dig it. I like it. I like the fact that we know about something we can never see, that will never exist. It's not like... Okay, so there's theories about how the universe is going to end.
Okay.
And one of them is the cold death or the heat death, or you everyone look at it.
Yeah.
Is everything gets so, you know, the universe is expanding, the stars are burning out,
right?
Everything slows down.
We're all going to die.
All energy goes out of the system, and you reach a point where there's absolutely zero energy there, like no heat at all. Mm-hmm. And you'll eventually go down to zero, like zero Kelvin or whatever. And somebody right now is typing, what about the background radiation beyond that?
Yes.
All that stuff.
That's my next question. Typing. What about the background radiation?
So that will, in theory, happen to the universe way the hell after this show. Mm-hmm. And I think it's funny that it's almost like a Monty Python skit in my head that will happen. It's completely silent. You can't see anything. And all of a sudden, a dude rips open the space-time continuum. Right there is zero Kelvin. And then two fans, high five.
Yeah.
Scientists are breaking open champagne, cheering.
You know how cold you described it? Those are my wife's hands in January. And she will chase us around the house wanting to put her hands down the back of our shirt.
Yeah.
Where, because for some reason, our backs are the warmest part of the body.
Yeah. It's...
And Jacob, Cameron, and myself. Hi, I'm Darren. I'm the co-host of this.
Yeah. Train wreck.
Irritable Dancing. Yes. We don't hate her, but we're not happy with her when she tries to put her cold hands down our warm backs.
Yeah.
It's like, stop it.
It's the same thing as black holes, in my opinion.
Yeah.
There's all this debate, and I'm curious as to what's inside a black hole, but you know what?
Who isn't?
It doesn't matter what's inside a black hole.
Right.
You're not going to see it. There's, like, I watch it go down the YouTube hole of all these people saying, you may go pop to another universe. No, you're not.
Is this Mike's Science Corner?
This is Mike's Science Corner. Science Corner. This is Mike's Science Corner. It's expanded. You're not going to see what's in it. It's not like you're going to the gravity tidal forces elongate you, and it's called spaghettiing you. You're not gonna live through that.
No.
You're not gonna pop out on the other. It's not like all of a sudden.
And why would somebody think that you could?
Yeah.
Crazy.
It's not like
people.
All of a sudden it's gonna be somebody's gonna call time. Like God's gonna say, Time, hold on, blow the whistle. Let's get him to the other side. Now here's what's inside. No. It's like they're just gonna see whatever is inside the black hole.
Mm-hmm.
We'll just see a puff of red mist go. There's Mike.
Yeah.
Dumbass. Oh, and those are his Funko Pops, his YouTube Funko Pops. That's it. I can see shit.
Yeah.
You wink out of existence. I also have another theory.
Okay.
And I was thinking about using this for a short story, so nobody copy this idea.
Okay.
Or maybe a novel.
Right. So everybody listening, just mm-hmm. listen.
Yeah.
Don't write anything down.
Yeah.
Go.
So the premise is this.
Okay.
Okay. You're not dead.
No.
You, Darren.
I'm dead inside.
But you're not dead.
Okay.
Okay. You see people not around anymore because they die. But you yourself have never died. As far as you're concerned,
right.
You know at some point you will.
Yes.
But you haven't yet.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
What if you're just supposed to be dying at different points, like through the multiverse or parallel universes? You know, uh-huh. like there's multiple copies of Darren out there doing all these things.
Yeah.
And what if in the timeline, mm-hmm. when you die in one timeline, you just jump seamlessly to another timeline where you didn't die? And you just keep on going like that. And nobody else is in your timeline, or maybe they are, who knows, but you just never cease to be. You can
have mind blown. I'm wondering, I think I'm probably in one of those multi-diverses.
Yeah, I think I'm trapped in a black hole right now. How the hell did we get here?
I don't know. And this has been Mike's
Science
Corner.
This has been Mike's Science Corner.
This portion of Irritable Dad Syndrome is brought to you by Whopper's All Beef Footlong Hot Dogs. Hey there, it's Dave, and it's never too early to get started on your holiday shopping. And there's no better gift than Whopper's All Beef Hot Dogs. That's right. Give that special someone in your life the gift of All Beef Footlong Hot Dogs. So what are you waiting for? Pre-order a package or two wherever quality meat products are sold. What? Your local grocery doesn't sell Whoppers? No problem. Whoppers delivers. Just go online and place your order today. Merry Christmas from all of us at Irritable Dad Syndrome and the fine folks at Whopper's All Beef Footlong Hot Dogs.
Megan Mitchell was our guest last week.
Yeah.
And you were talking about, you know, when comes just to a grinding halt. That happened last week. Great guest.
Yes.
I love her. She's fantastic. I thought she was very funny.
Uh-huh.
She played along with us.
Yes.
Everything was going great. And then I decided to ask her about Cocaine Bear. And you didn't see the look in her face when she's looking at me like,
what happened?
I don't know what you want me to do here.
I can't follow you here. I can't follow you here.
Previously on Irritable Dad Syndrome.
Our guest is Megan Mitchell, and speaking of guilty pleasures, I think the three of us should go to a movie. I saw a trailer, and let me know if this sounds interesting to you, Megan. It's in Knoxville, Tennessee. A bear, someone had like dropped a whole load of cocaine, and this bear gets into the cocaine and eats it, and then goes on a killing rampage. And I saw the trailer for that, and I thought, I might have to go see that, because it looks stupid enough to be entertaining.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not going to win any Academy Awards.
So it's basically The Revenant, but the bear's like from Miami Vice, right?
Is that? Yes.
Okay.
And it's a creative title, Cocaine Bear.
Yeah. Well, oh.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. It's like, good for you.
Yeah. So I finally watched the trailer for Cocaine Bear.
I
want to see Cocaine Bear.
I mean, I edited that part out of the show because it just went crickets, nowhere, absolutely nowhere. And poor thing, she just looked at me like, I want to play along, but I don't know what to do here.
I don't know where you're
going. She didn't have the book. She didn't have the instructions.
Yeah.
So, Cocaine Bear.
Another question.
Yeah.
Cocaine Bear, or another statement.
Okay.
So I watched the trailer for Cocaine Bear.
Yeah.
I really want to see Cocaine Bear now.
It looks horrible.
Especially since Ray Liotta. But I looked
at... that's right.
I love looking at the YouTube comments. My favorite comment was, glad to see that bear from The Revenant is still getting work.
Yes. Well, and you made the joke about The Revenant.
Yeah.
That's what happens to Smokey the Bear when people don't stop making forest fires.
This episode is going to be a train wreck for, and we're all over the place.
But
have you seen the movie The Gray with Liam Neeson?
Yeah. About the wolf?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
I didn't like it.
You didn't like that?
I mean, it was okay. Yeah, they ate it and then it tasted horrible.
What?
They ate a wolf in that movie, right?
Oh, no.
Yeah, they did.
Did they eat a wolf?
Yeah, they had to survive.
Yeah, he died.
Yeah.
He fought the alpha wolf at the end. You were talking about the same movie.
Mm-hmm.
It ends with him
going,
and the wolf going.
Yeah, and then he goes, and then
Yeah. When the pirate came out, went, "Arr!" By the way,
yeah.
Since we're talking about movies,
okay,
we have kids.
Yes. And well, not to, you and I not, don't have not kids
you and
together.
I don't have kids, but we've taken our kids to kid movies, and we've talked before about how we end up enjoying the kids' movies more than what is legally responsible.
Well, they make them differently now.
Yeah.
They used to just make movies that only the kids enjoyed, and then they brilliantly decided, you know, there's two people in the family who want to go, but four people end up buying tickets because these people who want to see the movie can't go by themselves. Let's give the parents a reason to watch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and I've talked about this before, and you know you're going to roll your eyes, but I want to call out to my favorite moment in any movie, kids related, is the SpongeBob SquarePants, Sponge Out of Water, when he visits the dolphin. And he's standing with the dolphin watching Jupiter, and the dolphin goes to the bathroom. He says, "I have to go to the bathroom." And this is in real time. It's not like it cuts back to the dolphin coming back. Mm-hmm. You hear the dolphin peeing or whatever. You hear it wash its flippers, all this stuff. Nothing's happening on the screen. SpongeBob is just standing there.
Right.
And then the dolphin comes back and he has toilet paper on his bottom flipper.
Funny.
I howled with laughter. Andrew, I think Andrew was maybe 4, possibly 5 years old. I laughed so hard and for so long at that moment, I actually embarrassed him.
Yeah.
As a 5 year old, I embarrassed, like, it quit being funny. He was like, "Daddy, stop, daddy." And that made me laugh even more.
Yeah.
People were like, you know, like looking at me, like, which made me laugh more. I could not handle myself.
Well, when we went to see the Minion Despicable Me 2.
Yeah.
I laughed so hard I damn near blacked out. Because you know I have coughing fits when I laugh.
Yeah.
I'm laughing so hard I start coughing. I coughed until I couldn't see for a second. I had to apologize to the guy, the poor son of a bitch sitting in front of me. It's like, "I am sorry." He goes, "It's okay.
It's okay.
It's okay." Yeah. I was laughing so hard at those minions that I almost just literally blacked out. And that's the hardest I've laughed since I saw Airplane at the theater. And, you know, they're talking about, you know, fall out of your seat laughing. I did fall out of my seat laughing at Airplane. Yeah. And I think it was when the hit the fan.
I just want to tell you both good luck. We're all counting on you.
Because as a kid, and then you hear them say that because a cuss word is funny.
Yeah.
Then you see it.
Yeah.
That's actual and then it... And then I couldn't handle
it. I lost it and fell out of my seat.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's Naked Gun 2.5.
Mm-hmm.
The guy in the wheelchair, he had like a birthmark on his butt. You know what I'm talking about? And Leslie Nielsen, he's giving
trying
a speech.
Sand it off.
He goes back. He's using a sander. I fell on the floor.
Yeah.
literal theater floor.
I like when he gets off the airplane. He was so excited that the crowd came to see him. Oh no, Weird Al Yankovic is on the same plane. Yeah.
This portion of our show is brought to you by a horse. You can pet it, you can feed it, you can have your picture taken with it. It's a horse. Now, back to the show.
I'm getting kind of tired of new technology.
Okay.
You make fun of me a lot.
I do.
Okay, and it's well deserved.
Okay.
My computer starts screwing up.
Yeah.
I don't know what to do with it. Our movie room, I had to buy a new receiver because our old receiver just completely just died on me. And so I spent about 3 hours hooking that up and getting
receivers are the worst.
Well,
man.
I was trying to get the speakers all wired up because there's 5 places to hook in the speakers, and the speaker wires, they don't just plug in. There's the exposed wire that gets twist, and I hate it. So I spent a good 3 hours or 4 hours doing that over the weekend. A couple weeks ago, our TV in our living room, the Roku box, we have a Roku.
Okay.
The remote, it just literally stopped working.
Batteries didn't, it wasn't the batteries?
It would not work. I went and I changed batteries and it still would not work.
Yeah.
To save my life, I could not get it to work.
You just quit watching TV at that point.
Well, I mean, we're like, you know, the movie room downstairs where we have a TV, that wasn't working because the receiver needed to be replaced.
Okay.
And then the Roku box stops working in the living room. I'm like, well, I'm not bringing the kids into our bedroom to watch TV because that's not allowed.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's where Libby and I watch our TV shows.
That's right. You said that I make fun of you. I used to, back in the day, I would loudly proclaim, why would anybody get tech support? You just figure this stuff out yourself and rewiring all this stuff. I've managed myself, but especially in the past few years, especially since we've been doing this stuff, I've been more apt to, if there's a technical problem, just I'm not doing that anymore. I guess I'm not using this device anymore because I don't feel like messing with it anymore. This thing has the capability to make a really good show.
Yeah.
We've just gotten it to the point where sound goes in and comes out to the computer.
Yeah.
And that ain't touching it.
Yeah. It's like. But I mean, I told you that we had the universal remote that I could not program.
Uh-huh.
And so then we have a Roku remote that just won't work at all.
Yeah.
Go on Google, and I have to literally, I have to unplug the Roku box, turn off the TV, turn the TV on, like do a rain dance or something, plug it back in, and then it works.
Yeah.
Like, what the hell?
That's this bullshit that technology has gone through. See, you kids, you damn millennials, back in the day, back in the 70s and 80s, everything had like screws coming out the back of it and little wires, and you would damn near electrocute yourself trying to get something to work. But everything was labeled. There were like 15,000 switches. Everybody was watching Buck Rogers and Star Trek. It was cool to have a lot of buttons.
Yeah.
Now you don't want to have any buttons.
Yeah.
That's my problem with Apple. You'll have a device that clearly needs at least three buttons.
Yeah.
Minimal.
Yeah.
Minimal. Ain't got none of them.
Yeah.
Just here, hold this for 2 seconds if you want to do this. Hold it for 3 seconds if you want to do this. Rub it on your butt if you wanted to do this.
Right. I do anyway.
Nobody got time for that.
Right.
But just put more buttons on the damn thing.
With a universal remote, just put a button on there that says program.
Yeah.
That's all you got to do. And you thought of that. Science Corner Mike thought of that.
The one thing that a universal remote is useful for is being able to be programmed for any device. Yeah. And that's the one function you ain't got a button on there for.
Yeah. Doesn't make any sense.
Lots we got a Roku box this weekend.
Yeah. Yeah. You can watch the Weird Al movie on Roku TV.
Oh, I deleted the Roku TV thing.
Why?
I deleted everything that we don't. It's anything free. That we don't have. I just took it off.
But My Name is Earl is on the Roku channel.
I don't know what that is.
I don't know what. It's free. I don't know why you deleted that. It's
okay. Yeah. I guess I can add it back on. Yeah.
Probably can.
Yeah. I told Bess, you know, she's like, well, she didn't realize that it's not a smart TV in our bedroom upstairs. We have an old TV and we just finally put it on the wall.
Yeah.
For something in there. And it didn't have anything, but we've got PlayStations left and right. There's so many PlayStations in this place. So I just took one of the PlayStations upstairs. Like, it's got all those things on it. Well, apparently, if I'm logged in upstairs, I can't do anything down here, which means if she's up there watching something, I can't shoot people or grind my camos.
Right.
And that's not going to happen. That's not going to work. So I went to go get a damn Roku device, and then I had to spend about 2 hours putting the passwords in for all these damn things, and I got to use the Roku remote.
Yes, you have to put the password in for everything. If Amazon, password.
Now, some of them did what good God-fearing Christian channels of yore did, which is go to this on your phone, sign in, and then put this code in, and you got it.
Right.
Those I got lickety split.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
The other ones were like, what's your email? Okay, I don't remember what email I had when I signed up for this. I'm going to guess it's that one.
Yeah.
What's your password? Here's my normal password. That's not your password.
Yeah.
And then you got to go to the bullshit of make a new password. Mm-hmm. You can't make something that's similar to your last passwords.
Right.
That one has too many identifiable things.
Right.
Apparently, you can't use your phone number and your social security number. Tried that. It gets so... So now I have this file.
You're like 2% milk lover, 1978.
So now I've got like 15 different passwords for all these things. I don't know what any of them are. But when I put them all up in the Roku, guess what it did?
What?
Every other device in the house now that wants the thing. Oh, what's the password? Because it changed.
Yeah.
You know what? Yeah. Nobody's watching anything in this house anymore.
I know.
I know.
Well, I had to fix our Netflix in the movie room. Because the menu looked fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay, you go to the Roku menu. Oh, my God. Pristine, sharp.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. It looks beautiful. Uh-huh. You go to Netflix. My God, it looks like it was projected against the wall of an abandoned Mexican prison. Okay? The video quality is horrible. Absolutely horrible. Yeah. And the kids are like, it's my fault. Dad,
what did you do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Turns out it was my fault. Did you know that you can have Netflix on too many devices?
No.
Yeah.
Well, so, what does that have to do with anything?
Well, because apparently...
It just degrades your quality if you have it too many times?
Yeah. Well, that's... I was theorizing. Okay. I was spitballing.
Okay.
I was trying to figure it out. And I was like, well, it hasn't been doing this for too long. I'm like, maybe I have it on too many devices. So I removed it from my phone. It looks great now. So yeah, you can have it on too many devices. Mm. Yeah. Mm.
Now you got me wondering, because YouTube looked weird the other day, and it's on the Roku. I wonder if that's...
Do you have it on your phone?
Yeah. It's on everything. It's on our toaster, I think. Yeah. It's on that dehumidifier.
See,
right there.
I love watching YouTube on my toaster.
It's, you know what? When we were looking for fridges, we have a fridge. I can't say it's new anymore because it's about 2 years old.
Yeah.
I wanted to look at like the insane fridges that no human should buy.
Right.
They had a fridge that you could, it had like a clear section. Mm-hmm. You push a button and it doesn't look clear normally. It looks like a stainless steel outside, but it's like one of those one-way mirror things. You push a button and you can see inside without opening the door. I'm like, what is the point of that?
Right. And then, my wife would look at it and go, oh God, we need to clean the inside of the fridge.
But then you
that's
you
why
do,
you close the door.
But it's actually there's also a tablet on the side there. Uh-huh. And you can scan items. Like if you are out of milk.
Yeah.
You could just, boom, I want milk, and it will order milk, and I'm assuming you're signing up for some service, some person brings milk to your house.
Well, I don't want, what is this, 1940? The milkman? We're going to bring back the milkman.
See, this
We're going to combine George Jetson and the milkman.
But see, this is, I briefly thought, man, if we were rich, I would totally get this because I just want to see it work. I want to do it. But it wouldn't work for me. I guarantee there's a thing where you can only get cheese, eggs, or rice.
White bread only.
Yeah. And what I would use it for is at 2 a.m, we're out of Chunky Monkey ice cream. Oh, yeah. Hell no.
Yeah.
Scan it. Boop.
I want it now.
Yeah. Jonathan is driving over from wherever to bring your Chunky Monkey. But the question is, did he get it last in the store or did he go in and get all kinds of orders?
Yeah.
And I'm going to get melted Chunky Monkey.
Yeah.
Some would say, you know what? At 2 a.m, beggars can't be choosers. I would say it's a $5,000 fridge. That Chunky Monkey better be correct.
Yes.
Just saying.
It better be.
There was one that had a camera inside the fridge.
Uh-huh.
So instead of opening the fridge, you push a button and you see a little video of what's going on inside your fridge.
Yeah.
I would have so much fun with that one too. I would put little action figures in there, like a little Hoth diorama.
Hey, you know, is this our Christmas episode? Is this our Christmas special?
I think so.
Did you see the Guardians of the Galaxy holiday special?
No.
I watched about 4 minutes of it and I could not continue it.
I figured they were trying to be a parody of the Star Wars thing.
That's what I thought too.
Come on, guys. What are you doing?
I'm eventually going to go and watch it because I'm afraid there's going to be something in it that happens later on.
Tony Stark's going to lose his nail clippers in it. And then that's going to...
And by the way, did you see the trailer for the new Guardians of the Galaxy
3? No.
It gives some... Well, don't watch it because it gives spoilers away.
Okay.
Yeah.
For that movie?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm so far behind on all the Marvel stuff, I don't even know what I can watch at this point. I got part of the way through WandaVision, and I told you back in the day, you weren't impressed with the first 4 episodes of WandaVision, and I said, eventually I'll get to it, and I'll love them.
Yeah.
I really liked the first few episodes of WandaVision. I dig them.
They bored us to tears.
I thought they were funny.
Yeah. And I'm watching She-Hulk now.
Yeah,
I can't. My God, She-Hulk
I just can't.
It's painful.
I can't watch.
Yeah.
I'm in another office loop. We talked about this with Megan. I'm going through the office again for the 4th time.
Yeah.
And I can't.
Why not? Why watch a new show that when you can watch The Office seasons 1 through 7?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. Well, I like the whole Office, but I mean, where we're at right now is the one where Phyllis is getting married and Michael Scott is talking to her right before her wedding.
Right.
And she just stops and says, Phyllis, did you break wind?
She married Bob Vance.
Yeah, Vance Refrigeration. What do you do for work, Bob?
I mentioned at the beginning of the show that my oldest son had a problem with his car where he parked it.
Yeah.
Okay, so Jacob is a member of Cywee, which is a Cincinnati Youth Symphony, something that starts with an E.
Okay.
So it's
Extravaganza.
Symphonic Winds something something. And it's at the University of Cincinnati.
Okay.
So we went down there to see them perform their holiday show.
Okay.
It was very good. And for whatever reason, we were in three cars. Oh, I know why we were in three cars, because Libby was working downtown.
Yeah.
And then Jacob was already down there because they had to rehearse before the show.
Yeah.
So I drove my mom and Cameron down there. So we have three cars.
Yeah.
So we all go. We watch the show. It's great. We're going, since it's our Christmas special,
yeah,
we're going to play a song that they performed at the end of the show. So stay tuned. we're getting ready to leave. And I drove Libby back to her car, and Mom and I are getting ready to come back. And when we get a call from Jacob, he has parked his car in the parking lot, and he has parked too close to a concrete pillar.
Okay.
He says, "Dad, I'm really close. I'm afraid to move the car. I don't think I'm going to be able to move it unless I hit it." I'm like, "Okay, stay there." Mm-hmm. I turned the car around, drove back. I wasn't that far.
Mm-hmm.
Pulled in, and honest to God, Mike, his car was so close to this concrete pillar, you might have been able to put a playing card, maybe two, in between. And it was really, mm-hmm, honest to God, very impressive how he got it that close, yeah, without hitting it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I was actually stumped for a second, like, how are we going to get this car out?
Yeah.
And we tried, because now I used to drive a Ford Escort hatchback, a four-speed.
When you
I
was just pick those up.
You know, yes, you could. Me and a buddy actually did that so I could get my car out of my parking spot at ETSU. Jacob and I couldn't lift his car.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, here we go. So I get in. You would have been proud.
Okay.
I went forward half an inch. I turned the tire. I went back half an inch.
Yeah.
Forward half an inch, tire back half an inch. Forward half an inch, back.
I think there's an episode of Mr. Bean where, yes, he's doing this for, yes, like the whole thing.
And Austin Powers, Austin International Man of Mystery, yeah, had to do that to get. And I literally did that, I think, 10 times. And if I can brag, Jacob was very impressed with how well I could. But I got the car out of there. And he was worried that I would be upset. I'm like, dude, I've always told you that if you need something, come call me and I will get you. Because had he tried, he would have just he would have taken the mirror off. But it was, very impressive how he parked that close without scratching it. Before we go, there's a guy who I used to work at WJHL with. His name is Mac McKinney.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm friends with him. I haven't seen him in, I don't know how long, 20 years?
Mm-hmm.
It's been a very long time.
Okay.
I got a message from him out of the blue the other night. It says, "Hey, I heard from a close friend that you've been hosting this podcast."
Okay.
And I replied to him. I said, "Yeah, I've been doing it for a little over a couple of years now."
Uh-huh.
I said, "I've mentioned it on Facebook 1,000 times. How have you not heard it?" And he says, "I'm never on Facebook." So that's,
well,
that
get
makes
on,
sense. Yeah, get on Facebook.
Yeah.
I asked him how he heard about it. He has a friend named Brad Barrick,
okay,
who lives in Elizabethton, Tennessee. He listens to our show.
Oh.
Yeah. He's been listening to it for quite a while now.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is rare. Somebody I don't know heard.
Listens. Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Somebody I have no idea who he is has been listening. I don't know where he heard about it.
Yeah.
But he calls up Mac and he says, "There's this guy named Darren Cox who keeps talking about Johnson City and WJHL. Do you know him?" And Mac's like, "Yeah, I do. Actually, we're friends."
Yeah.
So a shout out to Brad Barrick,
yeah,
and Mac McKinney. Mac, yeah, if you've, because he said he's going to try the show out.
Yeah.
So if he's listening, that's fantastic. We also have new.
Somebody listened to the first episode today. So a moment of silence for our fallen brother.
Well, now I've got another friend who I've met through Twitter. His name is Troy Purvis.
Uh-huh.
He found out about the podcast and started listening, and I told him, "Don't go back and listen to episode one."
Don't.
He says, "Too late." He says, he loved it. He says, "I loved how you guys were acting like you had no idea what you were doing."
We didn't have any idea.
There was no acting.
No.
So, yes.
It sounds very similar to this episode.
So, yeah, welcome to our new listeners.
Yeah. James Nungesser, friend of the show, sketch card artist.
He was on a few, four or five episodes
ago. Retired Marine, sketch card artist. He is actually selling quite a bit of his work. So
good.
Go support this guy.
Yeah.
Go help. He has been putting a bunch of stuff up. He messaged me Let me know that, you know, this stuff is up. It could really help him out for the holidays. Mm-hmm. You guys go look at his stuff on Facebook. It's James Nungesser, N-U-N-G-E-S-S-E-R, Sketch Cards. Dude has some pretty cool stuff on there.
He does.
A lot of good stuff. Yeah. So go check him out.
And somebody else that you can check out is Adam Neediff.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's got a brand new book about Monty Hall. He was on a few weeks ago. Great guest. He had a blast.
Yeah.
And you can go to Amazon and just look up Adam Neediff, N-E-D-E-F-F.
Yeah.
Or you can go to BearManorMedia.com and you can get some of his stuff.
And here's another thing you can check out is our door.
Yes. We've had close to 3,000 people.
Loving it.
Yeah.
Loving the shirt.
Yeah. We posted an ad for the, in my defense, I thought it was funny, t-shirt. Oh my God.
People went nuts.
Liking like crazy.
Loving.
And they're, they're sending it. They click on the heart and then the smiley face emoji.
They're sharing it with people saying, this is the perfect shirt for me.
Hey, Randall. Kevin would love this.
Yeah.
One person has bought one.
Yeah, we sold one.
3,000 people have liked it. And one person have bought it.
And we freaked out. I was like, are you sure
that
Libby didn't buy it?
And
then I'm thinking, well, maybe Beth bought one. I told her that I kind of wanted a new one, but I don't know.
Yeah.
So whoever bought that, if you're a listener, let us know.
Yeah.
Send us a picture of yourself in it. I want to know who bought this damn shirt.
Yes. If you buy any merchandise, by all means, send us a picture and we will put you on our website. We'll put you on our Facebook page, our Instagram, all that stuff.
So we're going to end this episode.
Yeah.
The next episode that we're recording right after this is our penultimate episode.
Yes.
Of season three.
Season three.
Season three's penultimate. Yes. So this is the one where Hank will get shot.
Yes. Don't spoil it.
Oh.
God, dude. What is wrong with you? But guys, Merry Christmas. Happy holidays to everybody out there. And we've had a great year. And we'll see you a couple more times before the year is over with. But again, have a great holiday season, and we hope to see you again on Irritable Dad Syndrome.
All right.
Well, that wraps it up for this week. I'll go back to the garage. You see, me and the little wife had a bit of a tiff, and I've been sleeping in the car. But that's okay. I like it in there. See you next time.